Hey guys, what's up? Eddie Aho here with KissAnalog.com. Today, I want to do a little investigation. I've got this Pico scope now, right? This little box down here, it's all buried under all these probes, kind of in the middle of a couple experiments, one of them being for this video. So, what I was thinking as I was doing some testing is, this guy is capable of 12 bits. It actually has high-res versions or modes where it can even go on a higher bit operation. And we're talking about the vertical resolution. Often we're talking about bandwidth of scopes, 100 megahertz, 200 megahertz, you know, 1 gig of samples per second, you know, that kind of thing. And we're worried about how it captures a signal in time, right? But also, you know, obviously we're capturing voltage. We're capturing a signal and amplitude. And so most scopes, I would say, I almost want to say all scopes, but there are a few scopes, and I'm going to review another scope very soon here. It's an O1, by the way. And, but this Pico, and there's only a couple scopes that I would say under, say, $4,000 or $5,000 that are not 8-bit. Most scopes, up until a few thousand dollars at least, maybe $4,000 or $5,000, are 8-bit scopes, okay? And in case you're not familiar with that, you're not quite sure what I'm talking about, I got my board. All right, so what I did is I kind of drew a portion of the display of a typical scope, maybe. 10 grids up, let's just say, to make the math easy and all that. Some scopes are 10 grids, right? Some, you know, today they come in different patterns, but let's say there's 8 or 10 divisions vertical. Well, an 8-bit scope, it's 2 to the 8th power, and that comes out to 256 levels. So your A to D converter on the input of your scope, it can look at a signal, divide it up in 256 steps, and take a reading. Well, when it does that, it doesn't look, let's say this is a 1 volt RMS, 1 kilohertz signal. It doesn't look at 1 volt and divide that up into 256 steps and slice it up and take little, readings. It doesn't do that. It looks at where your scope is set to, and if it's 10 divisions, it says, well, let's divide that up into, 10 divisions would be 25.6 divisions per, levels per division. So if it's 100 millivolts per division, you would have about 4 millivolts per little step. So if you have something that happens at 6 millivolts, it's going to think it's 4 millivolts or 3.9 millivolts. Once it gets over, you know, say 8 millivolts, then it's going to say, oh, yeah, I can, it's going to look like 3.9, like 2, 3.9 levels. It doesn't know it's 8. It's going to be just slightly less than that, right? So you get my drift there? a 12-bit is going to be 2 to the 12th power. That gives 4,096 levels, okay? So divide that by 10, it's 409.6, and that comes out, like over here we had 3.9, that'd be, in this case, it'd be 0.22 millivolts. So you get a lot better resolution, right? 4,000 versus 256. It's about 16 times, well, it is 16 times more. So, but can you see it? You know, that's the thing, right? Now, if you capture a signal and then zoom in and all that to try to see it, that's where it's really going to come into effect. But what I want to show you here on these scopes is, well, if we suspect something and if we see a little fuzziness, we might suspect it. And if we do see that, then we might zoom in on that instead of being, say, 100 millivolts or 500 millivolts per division. Like in this case, if we're looking at 1 volt RMS signal, we're probably going to be 500 millivolts per division. And then we would be like almost 3 divisions to get about 1.414 volts. You know what I mean? So a peak waveform to get 1 volt RMS. So in that case, if we saw some fuzziness and we wanted to zoom in on that, we would change our volts per division. And most scopes can go down to 10 millivolts, or most scopes can go down 10 millivolts in a times 10 probe. If you go times 1, you go down to 1 millivolt. But now you have some loading, because now your probe, the impedance is like, and also your bandwidth has changed, which that's probably an okay thing. Instead of a times 10 probe gives you like 10 mega ohms in input impedance. Times 1, you know, you're down to 1 meg, right? So, a lot of times we want to keep that impedance up, but the 1 times 1 probe might be better when you're looking at a really small signal. In this case, I'm going to leave it in times 10, okay? I just want to look at a signal, 1 volt RMS, 1 kilohertz, with a modulation, with the frequency riding on top of it, 100 kilohertz, 1%. So we could say we have 100 kilohertz, 1% of 1 volt RMS would be 10 millivolts RMS. So we could say we have 100 kilohertz, 10 volts RMS signal. And then we come in at 1 kilohertz and modulate that 1 volt. So this guy is riding on top. You can look at it either way, I guess. Anyway, what I want to do is I want to put this signal on out with the generator and then go zoom in and just see how well we can capture it with the 8-bit scopes. And I've got the GWN stack back here. I've got the mix sig, and also I have a signalant. So I'm going to use all three of those scopes compared to the Pico at 12 bits just to see, you know, if they perform equally or as well as each other. With this example and the fact that we can use our, say, our 10 millivolt range, you know, with the times 10 probe, we should be able to do that, right? So let's jump over here, do some testing, see what it looks like. All right, guys, so I've got my generator, the Unity generator, putting out a 1 kilohertz, 1 volt RMS signal, okay? So you see a 1 volt. I've got RMS both, this is cycle RMS, so it's looking at one cycle, and this is the entire, what's on the screen, 1 volt. And this is 1 kilohertz, and it's also showing it up here because I have the frequency counter, which shows up right there, okay? So now I'm going to spread it out a little bit so we can take a closer look. And lo and behold, it looks like we have a little oscillation on top, which we know we do because I put it there. It's 1% of the 1 volt RMS, and it's 100 kilohertz. So let's just zoom in on that. That's about all we can see of it right there. Now what I can do is I can play some tricks. And by the way, the measurements here, they're not working once I zoom in. They're not looking at this stuff up here. So let's see, what I can do though is I can pull this, whoops, pull my cursors down. I can pull this guy down and then, yeah, I can do that. So I can keep it on the screen. If I'm using more of my screen, I'm using more of those slices, that resolution, to pick up some details. So I got some more detail there. Okay, now I'm going to try to get these cursors lined up there, and I can fine-tune them with this little button down here and grab this guy. And I just have to eyeball it there. I mean, I think I could play around a little bit more and try to get a little bit more resolution by putting a basically a DC offset, putting it down there and trying to zoom in on this, but we'll just do this for now, okay? And let me see if I can move my trigger over just so I'm not on top of my cursor measurements. I wish I could move those around, but looks like about 48 millivolts peak to peak between those cursors, okay? Now, let's see if we can see what the frequency is. I'll put it on that guy, and then this one on near that peak. And then, let's see, the change of time is right here, 4.8, and about 119 kilohertz. So it looks like I'm able to, you know, even with 8 bits, if I play around with the screen setting, I can kind of zoom in. I can get a picture of that. You know, I think we're kind of getting on the limit though. But yeah, I can, with 8 bits, I can still see that I actually have 100 kilohertz signal and about 48 millivolts peak to peak. So yeah, I'm kind of roughing in on it. Like I say, if I put the signal down a little bit further, let's see if I can do that, and then zoom in. Yeah, about 10 microsecond, 100 kilohertz. Look, yeah, got a lot better resolution just by playing around with the controls of the scope. All right, so yeah, that looks a little bit closer. 27 millivolts. Peak to peak, that's probably, you know, I think that's probably getting pretty close, because 1% of 1 volt, I think it should be about 10 millivolts. So peak to peak, 27. Yeah, I think we're, you know, this scope is actually doing a pretty darn good job, I think. I think that's pretty impressive that we can get this. Now, if I hit the auto setup button up here in the corner, get back to our original signal. So normally, you want to expand and use as much of that screen as you can. See, I can't do that because, you know, so that's about where I am. Now, this, all these grids, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. On this one, I've actually got 10 grids on this scope. And those 10 grids, you know, divide up my resolution. So, and also, there is a thing where if you offset the signal, say you put it up here and put another channel down here, there is a slight difference in accuracy. It actually works best when it's in the middle of the screen. And I'm not sure if that's true with every scope, but the Keysight people say that's true with their scopes. And I think they actually infer that it's true with most scopes, if not all scopes. So anyway, but one thing I want to point out, when you're looking at this, it's really hard. You can see a little fuzziness, but it's really hard to actually see that you have a modulated signal on top of it until you really zoom in on it. And so just doing this and offsetting it, you go, wow, it looks like there is something there. You can spread it out. You can change your trigger to say right here at the top of the waveform, so it puts it in the center of the screen, right like that. And one thing I want to point out also is I have this on full bandwidth. Sometimes when you go to 20 meg, I didn't really see a difference, but sometimes, and this scope is really nice because it also has an adjustable bandwidth, which is really cool. So instead of 20 meg, I can say, well, I want 2 meg. I want even more filtering. So that's a really neat thing on this scope. And look at that. So there you go. So for 8-bit scope, this is pretty impressive. All right, now we're here with the GW Instec, and I'm coming in channel 3. These other channels aren't being used, so just channel 3 is lit up. Also, that reserves all the sampling and everything just for one channel. And 10 megabits memory depth, so we've got everything maxed out. And there's our 1 kilohertz signal. So yeah, you might see, notice a little fuzz on top. Again, now if I zoom in on this, and let's move the position all the way down. All right, guys, wow. It took me a moment. I put this at 10 millivolts. I did a whole bunch of twists on this to get the level. You see right there, levels all the way down 1.39 volts down there. So it, yeah, pretty crazy I could get it all the way down there. Here, let me freeze this. There we go. You know what? Let's go to bandwidth limit. Let's see if that helps clear up some noise. Yeah, sometimes that helps. There's 100 meg, 20 meg. We'll put that filter on. And then also, if I go to, let's see, DC, if I go to high frequency reject, this guy, yeah, you can do it. It just takes a little time. I'm going to go ahead and freeze it. Okay, there's our waveform. The Psycho RMS and all that, none of that's working because, yeah, it's just, it's not looking at up here it's looking off the screen. So let me get the cursors on and get the cursor of that one. And I don't know if you guys can tell, but it almost looks digitized. Like, you know, you can just about see the steps in there. Okay, 100 kilohertz. So we're able to capture the signal. That's the key thing right there. And let's get the other cursors going on here. I go right at the bottom of that waveform, top of that one, and we're getting about 29 millivolts. So it looks like we're getting fairly consistent results between the scopes. There we go. There's the GW Instech able to zoom in on that 1%, roughly 10 millivolts RMS on a 1 volt, 1 kilohertz signal. So we're seeing 100 kilohertz modulation on top of that 1 kilohertz. We can pull out the signals. It takes a little playing with the scope to do that, but we're capable for 8-bit scope to see that kind of resolution. That's pretty good. Okay, guys, the Siglent came out to play. He doesn't get a lot of action these days, but there's no reason that he shouldn't. Here, let's hit the auto setup. There we go. Our 1 kilohertz signal. Okay, I've got cursors up there. I wish I could get rid of the menus, but on the newer, the Dash E scope, I'm told you can get rid of the menus. But yeah, too bad they didn't come out with the firmware change for this guy. But anyway, so there we go. Now, let's say we're going to drop this signal down so that we can see that what's on top of that waveform. So let's blow it up a little bit, drop it down. All right, what do we get for change of Y? Change of volts is 30 millivolts. You know what? We're able to get this signal on all the scopes. It's just playing around with them a little differently to do it. The signal has that extra vertical resolution that has that extra step. All right, so you know what? That's 50 millivolts. I changed it so I could move it quicker and I forgot. So let me go down to 5 millivolts. Wow. Yeah, that, I don't know. Maybe. Yeah, you know what? That might not be a hardware. That might be a software zoom that allows us to go to that extra step. I'm not sure. Because, here, let's move the waveform over. Look how digitized that is. You can actually see the steps, right? 25 millivolts. You know, I don't know if, I mean, it's there. Yeah, I'm just not too sure about this. Okay, so about 100 kilohertz, you know, depending on where I place that. But yeah. All right, here we are with the Pico scope. Okay, now if we come down here at the bottom, it says 1 kilohertz, average 1 kilohertz. Well, that's what generators put in now on the average. Okay, now let's go zoom in on this section right here. From this point, it looks like a pretty clean waveform. Looks like there is a little fuzziness down here at the bottom, which might, you know, give us that hint or that tip that maybe we want to zoom in to see what's really going on there. So I'm on this little magnifying box right here. Or if I just hover, it says windowed zoom. So I'm going to do that. Come up here and just zoom in on top part of that waveform right there. Man, look at that. So there is our modulated waveform. Now, here, let me get these markers set up. What's nice is that we can see a nice waveform there. So with this 12 bits, see right up here, 12 bits, that, you know, we can see this. Now let's see if I can get that marker a little bit closer. It should be, yeah, right up here, 10 microseconds, okay, between those cursors. And it's about 22 millivolts here, peak to peak. So yeah, the reading down here, I don't know. It's saying, oh yeah, you know what? I do have peak to peak. In my mind, I was thinking RMS, but yeah, peak to peak, it's saying 30 millivolts. So
I want to show you another thing. Now, first of all, I hit this channel D and it shows the setup 12 bits, right? But you know what? We can actually, look at all this. We can actually go down, say, 16 bits. Look at that. That's kind of crazy, huh? I mean, you get really clean detail now. Now, this is going to limit bandwidth and stuff like that, but for what we're talking about here, it's fine. Now, look at the frequency down here. Now, it's giving 100 kilohertz. You know what? Let's add one more measurement. I'm going to do the RMS between. I want to do that AC. Yeah, let's do the RMS, but I want to do it between the rulers. Where are we? Average 11 millivolts. The depth is 1%, so I think that's 1% plus minus, so maybe that means 1% of 1 volt would be 10 millivolts, and that'd be RMS. Yeah, this is saying around 11.8, so maybe it is supposed to be around 10 millivolts. And the frequency, we're coming right in on frequency now. I wonder if I can even put these closer and if it can still do it. Yeah, it's still doing it. And now see over here the error? It's only off by a couple kilohertz or one and a half kilohertz or something. So, yeah, it's the all of a sudden we got a lot more accuracy. And that's because we went up here to 16 bits. So 0.1%. I don't know if you're looking at the wave, you'd even detect there's any noise on it. So here, let me get rid of the math. And if you zoom out, I can see the digitized steps, right? The little steps there. All right, there we go. So you kind of see the digitized steps, right? Well, anyway, that's 0.1% modulation. All right, there's the signal, looks nice. I don't know if you're looking at that, if you detect anything on top of that waveform. Yeah, it's pretty hard to see anything there. I don't know if I would go, oh, there's some 100 kilohertz ripple on that. Okay, it looks like I got the bottom of the waveforms. I went the wrong way with the thing, but that's okay. Bottom's same thing, right? Well, but I think you can see that you can't really see any, detect any ripple in there, right? Here, let me run this, and I want to make sure I turn off bandwidth is full. Let's go 20 meg. It's a little cleaner, right? Can you see it looks like the little notchy steps along there? But yeah, I can't really detect any ripple. It's it. All right, so here's our signal, 1 kilohertz, with the 100 kilohertz, 0.1% right on top. And, you know, it looks pretty clean. I don't think I would look at that and think that there'd be something on top of that. And if I wanted to zoom in, okay, so then I'll freeze it. Okay, so, you know, if I was looking at that, I don't know if I would even think that there's something riding on top of that. I'd probably think it's pretty clean waveform and maybe, yeah, I don't know. But let's say if I really wanted to go to 5 millivolts and zoom in, let's see what it looked like. All right, so I took some time and zoomed in on it, and I'm going to freeze it because right now it's just redrawing over itself. So when I freeze it, it just captures the latest scan, sometimes changing the horizontal one sitting back and forth will clean up the picture. But yeah, that's kind of the top of the waveform, the way it is right now. And maybe I can pull it up a little bit. But you can kind of see, here, let me let it go again. I'll freeze it again. It looks kind of chunky. You know, I think we're getting that digitized mode. Now this is a 5 millivolts. All right, guys, and this is what it would look like in the Pico. It looks like a pretty clean waveform. I don't think I would expect anything here. And even if I wanted to go into the higher bits, which I'm actually there right now, let's see what 12 bits looks like. I don't really detect any difference there. If I just wanted to grab, zoom in on the top of the waveform real quick just to inspect it, well, then I might kind of see a waveform that doesn't look perfect, but I may not expect anything at this point. Go to 14 bits. Maybe I'm not sure if I detect anything there. Maybe if I used to my generator putting out a better sine wave, then I could also go to this guy and go to this high bit, this resolution enhancement mode. And yeah, I might look at that and think, okay, maybe I do see something there. Yeah, it's possible. Let me go back to here. Okay, I got the 1 megahertz filter, and let's take it off. It looks like it's kind of moving around a little bit more, so maybe the filter does help. I don't think it'll go at 100K since I'm trying to look at a signal at 100K. So, go to 1 meg though. You know, it captures the signal nicely, and I do see like this bump. And it does seem like it's repetitive. So I might, and especially now that since I actually know that I put a signal on there, I'd say, yeah, I could kind of see it there. So the Pico does make it very easy to get up around and move. I'm really impressed with how easy it is to use this scope.
All right, guys. So what do you think? That was pretty cool, right? I want to thank my Patreons. Thanks, guys. Appreciate the support. And you can become a patron for as little as $1 a month. Just always like to toss that out there. And I want to thank everybody for watching the video, supporting the channel and all that. And a thumbs up to the video if you like it. That really helps the video analytics. And it really does help. And so I appreciate that. It's a free way to help the channel. And you know what, guys? I hope that was interesting, or you know how to use the scopes to kind of delve into that. And even at 8 bits, they're pretty powerful, right? I mean, the 12 bits of the Pico, really the software in the Pico makes the Pico really easy to zoom in and see that stuff within just like seconds or less than a minute, you know, for sure, compared to the other scopes where you have to do some dialing. Now, the MixSig is pretty fast too in comparison to the other scopes, I think, but yeah, what do you guys think of that? What I want to do is I want to show you what it looks like in an FFT. Because really, if you're suspecting or you want to just verify that you don't have noise or other frequencies, spurs going on, things like that, FFT is a great way to check for that, okay? So, now there's something cool about these scopes. Like even the 8-bit scopes and the audio stuff I've been doing, somehow they seem like they perform better than I think you would think they could. So, yeah, I think that's an interesting way to look at the signals. And that 0.1%, let's see what that looks like on FFT. I think you'll be impressed. So, all right, guys, hey, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.